Now I'd like to introduce this morning's closing keynote. It's been a wonderful, exciting morning. I don't know about you, but I'm having a great time and learning a lot. I'm going to welcome Pia Andrews to the screen. Pia Andrews is an expert in open and digital government. Over the course of the last two decades, Pia has been driving digital data policy and legislation transformation in the public sector, as well as evangelizing Gov as a platform. With the goal of enabling greater transparency, more democratic engagement, citizen-centric design, and a real pragmatic actual innovation in the public sector and beyond. Pia was awarded as one of the top 100 most influential women in Australia for 2014, and she was recognized in 2018 as one of the global top 20 most influential in digital government. I'm going to take a second because there's a quote that I think I love the depth of it. It's a quote from Pia, and it says, "Open that's not digital doesn't scale, and digital that's not open doesn't last." I've heard amazing things about you, Pia. You are an outstanding human being, and you keep yourself busy by saving the world. So everyone, let's give a very warm welcome to Pia all the way from New Zealand on our screen.
Oh my goodness. Thank you so much for such a warm and wonderful welcome. And it is great to be here and wonderful to see the other talks today. There's a lot of thought-provoking stuff, and I'm hoping to contribute just a little bit about my journey. So I've been in the senior executive only for a few years, and I've had a lot of lessons learned, and I guess I wanted to share some of those because I hear my peers across and bosses, frankly, across some public sectors across the world, constantly lamenting some of the same problems and constantly talking about how we don't have time and how there's too much email and too many meetings and too much. And the realization, I guess, I've been having is around how to balance urgency and importance. So I thought I'd share some of my lessons learned. I certainly don't claim to be the absolute best at this, but hopefully some of the little things that I've learned along the way will be helpful to you. So let's jump in. The first thing is a quick reminder. I do say this in a lot of my speeches, and I do remind people of this day to day regularly. We invented this so we can reinvent it. And the follow-up to that is, if we don't, who will? It's such an important thing to remember because people feel stuck often. They feel stuck by their position. They feel stuck by the limitations that they're in or the pressures that they're under. And the fact is that if something actually isn't working, you can change it. And if you don't, then no one will in some cases. I want to quickly reflect on COVID-19. COVID-19 has done three things to my mind. I'm a real patterns person. I see patterns and continually, and which is sometimes frustrating because when you can see a pattern of repetition, then you want to go to the causal thing. You're not always able to. But COVID has done three things. It has exacerbated and extrapolated, frankly, the gaps and inequities in the systems all around the world. It has, secondly, created, as a result of that, huge appetite for change, huge appetite for genuine transformation, which is great. But at the same time, it has accelerated iteration. On one hand, this is COVID, excuse me. On one hand, this is COVID specific, but this is a paradox of senior leadership. It's a paradox of everyone working in the public sector for several decades. It's just on steroids with COVID, because the fact is that the emergency paradox has actually been with us for quite a while. We've had exponential growth in speed, in declining resources, in silos, and all of this has led to what I call the exponential growing needs gap. Basically, the system around us, the needs of people, of society, of regulation, of industry, all of it is going much, much, much faster than the systems, processes of and analog mechanisms of government were ever built to respond to. So we really do need to be thinking about and reimagining government in the 21st century and looking for those patterns of, is this response that I'm doing going to scale exponentially, or is this a linear response to an exponential problem, at which point I'm just throwing my head against a wall. So really balancing urgency and importance, my lessons, and this very much came from some of the exceptional leadership training from the New South Wales government, actually, comes down to three things. Evolution of the self, number one. You can't, you know, evolve your team well, you can't lead well, you can't respond well from a position of calm unless you have good management of self. A strong, empowered team, number two. And number three, systems thinking. You can have the best team, best management of self, but still be doing a linear response to an exponential problem. And then the impact that you are able to have is only ever going to be decreasingly proportionate to the response needed. So first of all, know yourself. You can find by the walls you build yourself. You need to know yourself to grow yourself. Self-awareness is a lifelong journey. So thinking about how do you act at your best? I don't know if any of you have noticed, but there's a lot of really talented doers who then get promoted to management and to leadership and to executive, but don't get taught how to actually delegate, don't get taught how to manage, what to ignore and what not to ignore. There's often not that shift in training from being a great doer to being a great leader and indeed a great manager. I've heard people say, you know, don't manage, lead. You have to be able to manage and lead really well. And that means knowing how you act at your best, how you act at your worst, knowing that when you're under pressure, you know, for some people, for me, under pressure, I used to draw the people that I trust in closer and push the people I don't trust further away. And that doesn't work in a team. So knowing that you have that tendency means that, okay, I'm feeling under pressure. I actually need to really focus on all of my team and not ignore or pull in based on preference. You need to think about those circuit breakers. How do you know that you're doing the best thing? You know, to the previous speaker's excellent questions and ideas. How do you know that you're working on the right thing? How would you know that you've got the best ideas? If you're saying something, do you have the right culture in place for your team to feel comfortable, for the most junior person in your team to feel comfortable to say, hey, that's a bit crazy. Or that's a really good idea, or I've got this new idea. So what are the circuit breakers and feedback loops in your life, in your work, in your self? And I have what I call integrity networks. So I look for people that I absolutely respect their integrity, their expertise, their vision, their goals, and sort of try to engage with and test ideas with them. If you're only testing ideas with people that are friends, people that like you or that you like, then you're only ever testing ideas with a positive feedback loop. That's not going to necessarily give you the full truth. And mentors and role models, you know, seeking out people that inspire you, that aspire you, that have that next level. I remember hearing an amazing speech from a woman who went to be the head of revenue in the UK. So she went from being a FAS in Australia, a DepSec in Australia, so being in charge of a few thousand people to being in charge of, you know, 70,000 people or something ridiculous. And that shift in how to actually steer a ship of 70 or 60,000 people is a huge leap. So it really made me realize I'd spent a lot of time becoming an exceptionally good at having almost guerrilla warfare tactics, you know, small teams getting small things done well. And I needed to shift into how do I impact the system around me a lot better? Shift from, in my mind, from being a chess player to being a netball player or basketball or choose your team sport. But rather than trying to figure out how to route around things, figuring out how to make the best impact. So knowing yourself is critical, knowing what inspires you, knowing, you know, the impact of change on you and looking at what you expect from yourself, from others and from work and what legacy you actually want to leave. For some people, they just want to, get to the next day because that's all the time they have to think about. But if you think about what the actual legacy is you want to leave, it brings you back to that constantly. Okay, how is what I'm doing right now actually contributing to change or to the legacy I'm trying to bring? So the second key area here is to grow your team. I have really come to believe something quite profound, which has been the best way to scale is to empower your people. You can have the best technology solution in the world, you know, the best plan in the world, best program, best policy. But if your people are disempowered, then at some way along the path, it will either not be implemented as best as it possibly could be. It won't be innovated on. It won't be as responsive as it should. Someone will be able to see this isn't quite working, but won't be empowered to say or do anything about it. Actually empowering our people is how we get the best public outcomes. So here's a couple of my tips, I guess. Do your teams feel safe? When I start any job, I now talk about my three indicators of success. The first one is the measurable impact we have on the people we serve, which people understand and buy into. The second one is that we are looked to as an example for how we work, not just what we do, which goes to culture and goes to being an exemplar and always being the kindest, calmest person in the room, which is critical. But the third one is that every single member of my team have joy every day in their work. Now, it doesn't mean you love everything that you do all the time, of course. We all do work that we don't enjoy. But having joy in your work actually is an indicator that you feel safe, that you feel trusted, that you feel valued, and that you're doing something that you find meaningful personally. So joy is an interesting indicator that they probably have, if you like, their work Maslow pyramid taken into account. They have their psychological needs, their safety, their esteem taken care of. So there's a few things to consider. And the key one is that any change requires capacity. Everyone hears all the time, when we have time, when we get to that, if only we had resource. You don't ever have time. You only make time. So if you are prioritizing to do your email rather than talking to someone who needs it, if you are prioritizing to have meetings back to back all day, you have chosen to do that. So if you don't actually enable people to have a little bit of spare time, then of course they're only going to be able to do the thing that they're doing right now. If you say you have to have 100% of your resource on something, then there's no time for innovation, for reflection, for change, for addressing causal symptoms. You have to make time. And part of it, so the two key things that people need is, three key things they need is psychological safety, time, and Sam Pitts to play. Culture is a big enabler of all of this. And I've certainly, I used to see culture as, this sort of fluffy thing that wasn't all that important. It is now the most important, because within 3 months, if you really focus on your culture and really focus on your consistency of an amazing way of working and behaviors, and you will face your first test case where someone doesn't do the right thing and you have to do something about it, otherwise it all falls apart, then if you get the right culture in place, your team productivity will skyrocket, your productivity will skyrocket, and most importantly, you'll be able to have a far greater impact on everything that happens. This is about learning servant leadership, which is something hierarchical systems, interestingly, in some places work. So military are really good at hierarchy because they realize that it's not just about delegating work, it's about delegating responsibility. If you can't trust that the bullets are going to shift to the front line through all of the delegated responsibilities in place, you lose a war, so to speak. You need to not just delegate the work, delegate the responsibility, delegate the glory, delegate the vision to some degree. Being able to delegate is, and support your team to be makers, not just doers, in their own work is really critical. So I'm going to jump through a couple of things, but the final thing in knowing your team is to just check your privilege and help your team check their own privilege. We work in the public sector, or many of us. We are the cops as well as the social worker. People know that. So how are you going to address power imbalances? How are you going to ensure ethical outcomes? And how are you going to create public capacity to contribute to what you're doing? Because it's not just about freeing up your own, the time of your team. It's about creating the mechanisms to free up other people's time. People try to figure out, oh, we've got this new service, how are we going to market it to people? I mean, people are too busy to read our marketing. If we're the government, if the services we're providing, we can't provide at the right time and place suitable to a person's context, then we're probably doing it wrong. And I think we lean too heavily on marketing now because marketing is such a private sector lever for getting something into a person's domain or world or headspace. Too often we sort of fall back to that as a crutch, but the general public also have time constraints and are full-time at work and then full-time at home and don't actually have time to necessarily read all of our marketing or learn that that blog is happening or learn that that consultation is happening. How do we go to where they are and actually create the ways and spaces for them to be able to contribute into policy and service design and delivery? So thirdly, and I'd say most importantly, but if you don't do the other two, none of this is possible, understand the system around you. Shifting from iteration to transformation is key. And I've got a couple of notes in this deck that will be helpful to that and thinking about the difference between making iterative difference and transformative difference. But I want to quickly focus on this. This is how you balance it. Because people say, oh, yeah, transformation is really important, but I'm just too busy. operationally, we're just too busy. We've got all this stuff to do and all this pressure and we just have to do it. Here's the thing. That's never going to go away. It's never going to become less. So start with splitting your time, maybe 90-10. Actually, take your work program, take the time and resource of your team, look at your program of work and say, well, okay, let's look at it with the lens of fast value or long value. So this is my little Eye of Sauron diagram that I invented in New Zealand, which is why it's got a distinctly Lord of the Rings flavor. But the eye at the top, let's start with, is your boss, or it's the minister, or it's the public, right? Everyone is looking at what you're doing right now. Fast value is actually how you build authority. Because if you haven't delivered something this week, this fortnight, this month, there's a question, you know, well, what value are you bringing? You could have literally saved the world yesterday. And the next day, what have you done for me lately, is always a big deal. So you need to have a program and roadmap and visibility of fast value, showing that you are delivering value in whatever domain you're in. I mean, whether you're in policy or service delivery, whatever it is, delivering value regularly. But if you don't do any long value stuff, and this is where a lot of labs and a lot of innovation agendas have really fallen down. If you have 100% on fast value, because that's the pressure that you've got, then over 12 to 18 months, you start to lose credibility. So you need to have, in any case, a proportion of your program, a proportion of your effort on long value, the things that actually affect long-term policy outcomes, long-term service delivery outcomes, long-term improvement. Otherwise, you're just doing fast value and contributing probably to some sort of technical, administrative, or even cultural debt. So I would love to have a 50-50 split, and I try to split my programs around 50-50, but even if you only start with 10%, if you took 5%, 10% of your current resource and started saying, okay, I'm going to free up just a couple of people to look at the trends, to look at the patterns. Oh, look, this rising, you know, trend of issues that we're dealing with is actually coming from this source here. I'm going to solve that. I've now dealt with an exponential problem with an exponential solution. So freeing up just some of your capacity is absolutely key, and no one else is going to do that for you. You will always be under pressure. You will always be under heavy impact of change. So freeing up some of your capacity to be able to deal with that is absolutely crucial if you want to actually be high impact and successful in what we do. How do you actually have a meaningful pipeline of stuff to improve? Well, I've got some tools and tricks here. Here's a very simple pipeline that we had in a previous role that we're starting to build in my current role. The idea is, again, to actually have a way of organizing of this. I won't go through that in detail. It's really just there as an example, but also looking at the system around you. You can't have agile service delivery if you don't have an agile organization. How does your budgeting work and impact it? How does your project funding versus product or services funding, looking at your what an MVP is rather than trying to launch with 100% with something which is 100% done, which is how things break and don't really work. I always joke that waterfall has its name because it always runs off a cliff. And how do we transform everything from policy to procurement? And the final thing I'll leave you on with system is people can't change to what they can't imagine. So working openly is critical for this, because showing the thing and showing how you do it will help people imagine something different and move to something different. So I've got some ideas there about system levers and such. I'm going to finish before we go to some questions on some key questions to ask yourself and really to think about. Who are you, what drives you, and how do you bring your best self to work? Who's responsible for managing your time, calendar, email, and stress effectively? Who's responsible for the well-being, health, and productivity of your team? And who's responsible and accountable for the impact of everything you and your team do, whether intentional or not, whether with good intentions or not? Even negative impact is your accountability. You, me. There is no justice, there's just us. My favorite quote by Terry Pratchett. And of course, I encourage you all to be the change you want to see in the world. Don't complain about not having enough time, make time. Don't complain about that problem over there, make it. Make that change, even if it's just in your team. Make the change so that you can live something different, even if there's absolute chaos and anarchy happening around you. So think about what you could do next, and I'd really looking forward to having a couple of questions.
Hey, Pia. So Hi. Good to see you. What time is it in New Zealand?
Oh, it's a fabulously 6:04 a.m., which is perfectly reasonable.
Good morning. So, as always, fantastic talk. I was watching, there's an Eddie Izzard movie called Castles in the Sky about how they built radar in World War II. And he's a meteorologist, so he knows things about bouncing signals off the stratosphere and stuff like that, even though the government wants him to go, you know, with military experts. And he brings on a bunch of his friends, other meteorologists, and they have this kind of skunk works, and they're solving the problem. But he suddenly turns into a boss, and he's yelling at them, and he's, you know, representing what the minister wants and all this. And one of his colleagues takes him aside and goes, "You're one of us. You're not one of them. But this organization doesn't exist without all of us." Like, I loved this idea that the collective is this other thing than the individuals, and that, you know, you are both serving the collective and also part of the collective, which wouldn't exist if you weren't there. And it really speaks to what you said. Like, it touched me in a very profound way for some reason, because I think it underscores this idea of servant leadership, that, like, yes, you are beholden to the group, but the group wouldn't exist without you. So the group is beholden to you in a very reciprocal way. Mm. How do we get people to internalize that? Like, what culturally, how do you get them to realize that there's this duality of you work for the group, but you are the group and it would not exist without you?
You know what? I think that just realizing that is probably a start. I think for a lot of people, well, I'm the boss, so I have to act like the boss. One of the small things that has really influenced my leadership style in government and in everything, actually, is that I spent so many years doing voluntary things, doing community things, where all of the and I usually ended up in a cat herding. I never called myself boss or manager. You know, you're like a cat herder, right? Knowing how to manage volunteers where they're not there because they're paid to be or because they have to be or because they're scared to leave, but they're only there because they want to be there, means that you have to understand their hopes, their fears, their individual competencies. And when people can't deliver on something because of life or any reason, you have to be able to help them exit with kindness, exit gracefully. And you have to keep your finger on the pulse so that you can keep the show running without actually them losing any face in the process of doing it. So it gave me, I think, a lot of instincts for how to do a similar thing with people who happen to be paid to do the job, but the motivations are no different. So, and realizing that being a great manager actually means your people don't need you and are able to thrive without you, I think, you know, is a real shift for people. If you want to have impact, empower your team. If you don't, you know, hog the light.
And I think that's absolutely, Christina's point was the team that managed itself, right? The team that ran itself. Well, as you said, the show must go on. It's always too short, but I'm sure we'll see you more during the week. Thank you so much for being here. And we're going to bring back Jacqueline as well and get things moving forward. Always great to see you.
Thank you.